So this is again another patient who has, was a smoker, young patient, 30-year-old patient. Again, he came within 3 hours. And this patient also, this patient also had primary angioplasty. You see, this is an angiographic picture where you can see one of the branches is totally occluded. I will just show you. See this branch, this is the right coronary artery. It's got two branches. One of the branches will have to go like this. The other branch is here. This is PDA. The posterolateral branch is the posterior descending artery. This artery is totally cut off. If you see, there's only flow and there's a stump here. So there is totally cut off of the, this young man came with the inferior wall MI. So if you see this, what we are doing now is just using aspiration. If you see this small dot here, this will keep moving up and down. This is aspiration where we are aspirating the clot out. You see this is moving down and moving forward. I am just pulling and taking it out, taking the clot out. If you see after removing the clot, you are just seeing the big branch coming up. And you see there is a block here and it's totally blocked at this point. After removing the clot, you are seeing the flow coming back. And now after that, what we are doing is we are stenting by using a balloon. And this is the final. You see there's a big branch now and this is being opened in a timely fashion. So there are, the most important factor is the time, and if you do this in a timely fashion, we can save muscle. So I will just move on to show you one more case, last case. So this patient is a very interesting patient who had a 20, he's a 24-year-old male who had no risk factors, and he had complained of a chest pain with back pain when went for swimming. And then after a long delay, because they initially thought it was non-cardiac and present to the hospital very late. So the presentation to the hospital was 9 hours after onset of chest pain. So it's a very, very long delay. As I told you already, when the delay is longer, the clot burden is very huge. And we have a huge burden, clot burden. It is very difficult by using thrombolytic therapy. We cannot treat and achieve flow. We have to remove the clot manually using devices. So in this patient, we did an angiogram and this found that major blood vessel is totally cut off. See, this is the left-handed descending artery. It is totally cut off and there is no flow at all. So this patient, we had to pass a wire into the branch and then start trying to aspirate the thrombus. But it was very difficult with repeated thrombus aspiration and then stenting. We had almost two, 3 hours of work in the angioplasty in the midnight. We removed a huge clot. It looks like a worm. You see, there's a two big clots. This has been removed from the patient. And we removed it. After we removed, the flow completely restored. And you see, this is the flow after the entire artery, which is totally blocked here. There is a full flow now after we removed the clot. So, to summarize, the acute heart attack is caused by a block rupture, which leads on to thrombus or clot formation, so which occludes the artery completely. So valuable time is lost in confirming the symptom of cardiac origin. The symptom is cardiac origin mainly by the patient. Then he loses a lot of time, and then he's offered a fresh clot. So fresh clot should be handled very carefully, gently, because any hard or any use of forced balloon can cause distal embolization and fragmentation of the clot. So there is a lot of advantage of immediately opening the blocked artery, and it can prevent irreversible damage, thereby improving survival. And we have a lot of challenges in a patient where the clot can embolize, it can get into the brain. So we have to be very careful, and a lot of challenges are there and should be performed by an experienced operator as quickly as possible. So the outcome should be optimized by using the shortest door to balloon time as possible with a radial approach. Use of prasugrel 60 mg rather than clopidogrel. Bivalirudin is another new direct thrombin inhibitor, and ready to face challenges, thrombus suction and stenting are all to improve the outcomes in acute MI. In future, we will save more time as we are going to have more sophisticated systems where we can, through the EMS, through cell tower, the hospital can be immediately informed, and the patient can be prepared in the ambulance with 2B3A, and patient can be shifted directly to the cath lab, and by the time the patient arrives, the cardiologists are ready waiting for the patient, so that in all that we try to reduce the time, so we save the muscle. So To conclude, acute MI is a very highly challenging because you know that there can be complications like hypotension, heart failure, acute heart failure, and arrhythmias is again a major problem. Thrombus, huge thrombus, and patients can have disembolization and no flow. With all this, they can have increased bleeding because you use a lot of antiplatelet drugs. And again, renal failure is again a problem, particularly in elderly patients who often have associated diabetes. So use a contrast can lead to nephropathy. So with all of this, we have to take all the precaution, but nothing is more rewarding than a primary PCI. Thank you for your patient listening.
And what do you do for
re-stenosis? In acute MI scenario, we are not completely covered. The primary aim is to re-establish flow in a blocked vessel. So we're talking about entirely a new phenomenon called re-stenosis. Re-stenosis is a scar tissue which forms after stenting. It can form after a primary angioplasty, it can form after any elective stenting. So it's called re-stenosis. It's like a scar which occurs after a surgery. So that happens in a patient who has a bare metal stent, the chance of re-stenosis is about 15 to 25%, depending upon diabetes and location and the vessel size. So it's small vessel, large vessel. Small vessels have a larger instance of re-stenosis. With the drug-eluting stents, now the re-stenosis rate is as low as 0 to 5%.
Do you routinely verify the patency by repeating an angiogram in all patients?
Because the treadmill and the stress test, they use treadmill stress test for the thallium test is what we usually follow in the first 3-6 months, 1 year after the angioplasty. But in selected patients where we think it's very important to confirm the stent patency, for example, in the proximal LAD or left main location, then we perform an angiogram at the end of 6 months in a bare metal and 1 year for the drug-eluting stent.
Recently,
you
introduced this biodegradable stent.
Biodegradable stent is a very, very promising technology because stents are so far what we have with this is made of stainless steel, and now we are going to have a stent which is made of a biodegradable product, which means the stent is going to get dissolved and get completely disappear from our body. So the function of the stent, we have a drug which eludes over a period of 45 days to 1 month. 1 month to 45 days, and then the stent disappears over a period of 6 months. So this concept is very excellent, and the initial results are very encouraging, and we are just going through the first human trials, and first 100 patient trials going on in India. And for commercial availability is going to take more than 2 years. By 2012, we are going to have commercially available biodegradable stents. But we have to have more long-term data, but the initial data is very encouraging, because even the use of antiplatelet drugs can be shorter, and the patients who have stents can undergo bypass surgery later because we don't remove the entire thing, it disappears. So it's a very promising technology which is going to come in a very short time.
But at the age of 24, you have got 3 or 4 big problems.
I will tell you about the 24-year-old, but please remember, the clot has nothing to do with the age. Any acute MI, the pathology is clot. So I told you initially, the acute MI means clot. Any patient, that is why we are targeting with antiplatelet drugs, everything. So clot was expected in this patient because he was a 9-hour delay. He came after a 9-hour delay, so clot burden will be more than any acute MI regardless of the age. But this particular patient had no conventional risk factors like diabetes, smoking, hypertension. But any young patient who comes like this should be investigated for unconventional risk factors like lipoprotein little a, high elevated homocysteine, or hypercoagulable states, or congenital coronary anomalies. Many things need to be evaluated. But even otherwise, now we find without any conventional risk factors, we find like patients in a very young group, age group like from 25 to 40. The reason again being the lifestyle changes, particularly in our country. Is now we are seeing more younger patients that do with severe form of disease, and the future is again not very good. We know that the sad story is we have been called the coronary heart disease capital of the world, and we have won the prize for that, unfortunately. So the, we have to do change our lifestyle, and lifestyle modification should start very early in life.
When do we do CT angio for post angioplasty evaluation?
See the duration, normally as I told you after stenting we do follow up after 3, 6 and 1 year. Angiographic follow up is done after 6 months in a bare metal, 1 year after drug-eluting stent. The question whether you are going to do a 64 slice, 320 slice coronary CT or an angiogram again depends, because you see a coronary CT has got its own disadvantages. If, for example, I have seen lots of false positive cases, and we do only in selective patients, like where we want to detect pre-critical atherosclerosis. For example, we want to know whether we need to start the patient on aspirin. Despite for high risk factors like a very high family history, diabetic patient, smoker, then if we find a minor 30%, 20% block, then we have an indication to start aspirin. So that is a big role for a 320 slice or a 64 slice CT scan. But other than routine following up for stent, we don't routinely recommend a coronary CT scan. That's what we have been shown, that first 12 hours is a time period before which we intervene either with pharmacological or mechanical forms of therapy, that myocardium can reverse to normal. Beyond 12 hours, the mortality is higher, then irreversible damage sets in, and despite revascularization, the benefit will not be very great. First 12 hours is important. And again, I told you, now we are not even talking about hours, we are talking about minutes. So every minute delay is permanent damage to the myocardium.
Angioplasty for more than one vessel?
We have been doing multiple number of multivessel angioplasties depending on the scenario and the type of patient. It depends upon the age, because you know young patients are better taken for multivessel angioplasty, location, and we do multivessel staged angioplasty.
Thank you, sir.